capital of the United States, December 8, 1941. Today, the Congress of the United States convenes in a solemn joint session, a session that will hear the President of the United States deliver his message that will ask for a declaration of war with Japan. The House chamber, always looking small and overcrowded, has today attained a dignity that overcomes even the great girders that temporarily support the glass roof of the chamber. The gallery started filling early this morning and, of course, are now packed. To witness this historic occasion are most of the dignitaries and officials of the Capitol. At 12 o'clock, the Speaker of the House, Sam Rayburn, called the House to order after a brief prayer by the Chaplain of the House, Dr. James Sherrill Montgomery. The House passed the resolution which provided for the joint session, then recessed until the call of the chair, which is expected shortly before 12:30. While we wait for the members of the Senate, the members of the Cabinet, and the Supreme Court, we have here with us Columbia's Washington News analyst, Mr. Albert Warner, who will speak at this time. Mr. Warner.
Representative Sam Rayburn, Speaker of the House of Representatives, has just called the House into session again. There was a brief session beginning at 12 o'clock, which lasted for 4 minutes. During that time, a prayer was offered by Dr. Cheryl Montgomery, the chaplain of the House. In that prayer, the chaplain spoke of the crimson threads of sacrifice which lie ahead. He spoke of national unity and honor and integrity. A resolution was offered at that time by Representative McCormick, the majority leader, which allowed the suspension of rules during the rest of the day. Then a motion was in order to recess. That recess has now ended, and the speaker has again wielded the gavel, calling the House into session at 12:30. A special joint session of the two chambers, House and Senate, will begin, and the President of the United States will be heard addressing Congress, asking for the declaration of the existence of a state of war. Congress is poised to give that declaration. There's no doubt about the sentiment of Congress. You can hear it from House and Senate members on every side. All differences have been laid aside. Representative Martin, who is the chairman of the Republican National Committee and also the minority leader of the House, has said he is ready to follow the president's lead. Isolationists like Senator Wheeler and Representative Hamilton Fish have followed in Mr. Martin's course and have promised to go along under the president's leadership. When the joint session is held at 12:30, the cabinet members, you can already begin to see some of them in the lobbies here, will be grouped right in front of the rostrum where Vice President Wallace will preside with Speaker Rayburn. Right behind the cabinet members and Supreme Court justices will be the senators, and then the House members and their regular benches. At one side of the rostrum, you may already see in uniform the heads of the armed services. There is Admiral Stark, Chief of Naval Operations. There is General Marshall, Army Chief of Staff, and General Holcomb, Chief of the Marine Corps. After the president has been heard, each chamber will assemble separately, and later in the afternoon, the war resolution will come out of committee for action. Now, here is the text of one resolution which Senator Connally has already prepared. Senator Connally will introduce the resolution in the Senate and Representative McCormick in the House. Connally's resolution reads as follows: declaring that a state of war exists between the Imperial Japanese government and the government and the people of the United States, and making provision to prosecute the same. Whereas the Imperial Japanese government has committed unprovoked acts of war against the government and the people of the United States of America, therefore be it resolved by the Senate and House of Representatives of the United States of America in Congress assembled, that the state of war between the United States and the Imperial Japanese government, which has thus been thrust upon the United States, is hereby formally declared. And the President is hereby authorized and directed to employ the entire naval and military forces of the United States and the resources of the government to carry on war against the Imperial Japanese government, and to bring the conflict to a successful termination. All of the resources of the country are hereby pledged by the Congress of the United States. Here on the House floor are representatives who have acted on another resolution of war, a declaration that was made 24 years ago. We interrupt to say that the Senate is now coming into the House of Representatives. They have marched across the whole length of the Capitol from the Senate side of the building where the Senate previously was in its own session. Here on the House floor are congressmen who voted against the declaration of war 24 years ago. There is, for example, Representative Knudsen of Minnesota, who voted against war on Germany in the First World War. He has gloried in that vote. He has been an ardent isolationist. He has criticized all of Mr. Roosevelt's foreign policies. But now he says, it is my opinion that a state of war already exists. If the resolution recognizes the Japanese aggression, my vote, he said, will certainly be yes. And then there is Miss Jeanette Rankin of Montana. Hers is an unhappy public career. In 1917, she broke down and cried as she voted no on the declaration of war. Soon thereafter, she retired from Congress, and she came back after a lapse of about 20 years in the last election. Now it is her duty to vote again on a war declaration. She has not yet said what she is going to do. Now, Speaker Rabin is wielding the gavel on the rostrum. From the State Department, we hear that Secretary of State Hull has told reporters that he is seeking to repatriate Ambassador Gru and his staff from Tokyo, as well as other American nationals in Japanese territory. Now here's Park Simmons.
Thank you, Mr. Warner. Presiding at the joint session, of course, is Representative Sam Rayburn, Speaker of the House, and Vice President of the United States, Henry A. Wallace. The Speaker will present the President, and we understand that we're not quite ready to go to the Speaker's platform as yet. The Supreme Court at this time, I believe, is walking into the chamber, and the Cabinet is also coming in at this time. And so after they come in, the President of the United States will arrive, and at that time, we intend to turn you over to the Speaker's platform. However, before we do that, here is the history of that fateful Sunday yesterday, which brings this joint session today. At 9:30 a.m., Secretary of State Cordell Hull arrived at his desk. At 10 a.m., Secretary of the Navy Frank Knox and Secretary of War Henry L. Stimson entered Hull's office. At 1 p.m., Knox and Stimson left. Japanese Ambassador Nomura telephoned Hull asking for an appointment at 1:45, and at 1:30 p.m., reporters, photographers, and newsreel men advised to be present for something big, and that was the story of that fateful Sunday of yesterday, beginning at 9:30 a.m. with the important developments and ending approximately at 1:30 p.m. At 1:35 p.m., more State Department officials arrived, and then Undersecretary of State Sumner Wells was with them. We turn you now over to the Speaker's platform and open our microphones at that point. No business at hand at the Speaker's platform, as we had presumed to be, and so we will continue from this point. The House is very crowded. Immediately outside of the door from which we're looking at the House floor, we can see that the members of the House of Representatives, as well as the Senators, the Supreme Court, and the Cabinet, have thoroughly crowded the House floor. Just outside the door, the people are very thickly crowded between our door and the rail at which we watch the proceedings on the outside. And I believe Mr. Warner is here again, and I think that he has the prayer which was read earlier by the chaplain. Is that right, Mr. Warner?
Right.
Now, here's Columbia's Washington News analyst, Mr. Alfred Warner.
At the present moment, Vice President Wallace and Speaker Rabin are sitting down on the rostrum waiting for the arrival of the President. Dr. Cheryl Montgomery, the chaplain of the House, opening the first preliminary session of the House at 12 o'clock this morning, offered a prayer as follows. Eternal Father, strong to save, to thee we lift our prayer of steadfast hope and faith while the calendar of history is being stained with pagan cruelty and deceit. We pray for life-giving calmness, majestic and invincible. If we are to suffer as a noble people acquainted with grief and sorrow, O grant they may be heaven's challenge, turn us more devoutly to the blessings of the Spirit. O thou, Christ God, in the deeper processes of our nation's soul, hold us steadfastly to the realization that the richest garments of a country's character are often sewed with the crimson threads of sacrifice and suffering. Keep us free from passion and hate, and bless our land with the enduring prizes of national unity, honor, and integrity. Here's Park Simmons.
Thank you, Mr. Warner. In the escorting committee, which is left to escort the president in, there is Majority Leader Joseph Martin, Senator Carter Glass of Virginia. Rather, that's Minority Leader Joseph Martin, Majority Leader of the House, also Representative John McCormick, who is the Majority Leader of the House. The committee is coming in at this time, and I believe the president is arriving. Mr. Warner, do you see him at that point now?
The president is already in the building, but has not yet appeared in the House chamber. He has gone up Pennsylvania Avenue to the Capitol amid Washington streets, which have already changed their appearance. You see uniforms on every side. Army and Navy men attached to the Army and Navy, War and Navy departments who were in civilian clothes are now in uniform. There are guards in steel helmets in front of the Navy and War buildings. Traffic has been blocked from the two streets on each side of the White House, and no one can enter the White House grounds without being thoroughly identified.
The president, I believe, will be coming in just a few moments. He is scheduled to arrive at approximately 12:30, of course, and it's now just 2 or 3 minutes before 12:30. However, in the meantime, before he arrives, we can bring you just a bit more about what occurred yesterday, the events which led to this joint session of Congress. At 1:35 p.m., there were more State Department officials arriving, among them Undersecretary of State Sumner Wells, and at 2 p.m., the Chinese ambassador, Dr. Hu Shi, was shown into Hull's office. At approximately 2:05, now these events were occurring rather rapidly, at approximately 2:05 p.m., Nomura and Special Envoy Saburo Caruso arrived 20 minutes late and were cooled off for 15 minutes in the anteroom of Hull's office. At 2:15 p.m., President Roosevelt was advised of the Hawaii bombing. At 2:30 p.m., the Chinese ambassador left Hull's office and the Japanese diplomats were shown in. At 2:22 p.m. yesterday afternoon, Early advised the press associations, that's Mr. Stephen Early who advised the press associations of President Roosevelt's telephone conversation. The president is arriving right now, accompanied by his escorting party from the House. He's coming in rather slowly. There are officials of the Army and Navy with him, many of them in uniform. As today, the Army and Navy was ordered into uniform. They're moving rather slowly now. There is a number of policemen to his rear, several other distinguished gentlemen following him, other policemen coming through now, and the president is moving into the House. We're going to move our microphone to a point more advantageous and see if we can give you more of a description of the president moving into the House of Representatives. The official party has passed the point at which we were observing just a moment ago, and the president has moved around to the rear of the House near the speaker's platform, the entrance from which he will arrive. The official party hasn't entered the doors near the speaker's platform at this time just yet, and we're walking out into the House floor, waiting for his arrival, and from that point we shall attempt to bring you a brief description of his arrival and those coming in with him. Someone has helped us stand on the railing so we can get a better vantage point and give you more of a description of just what is occurring. The House is very crowded, as we told you earlier, and Mr. Warner mentioned that also. The entire House is rising now, if you get any of the noise and the gravel at the floor, and so we will turn you over to the speaker's platform at which the business at hand will be carried on. We take you now to the speaker's platform as the president is arriving.
For the president, and he is now on the speaker's platform, walking up to the battery of microphones near Speaker Sam Rayburn. On his left is the House mace, which is always placed on its marble stand when the speaker is on the platform and presiding. President Roosevelt is now in front of the battery of the microphones, and we take you to the speaker's platform.
senators and representatives, I have the distinguished honor of presenting the President of the United States.
Speaker, members of the Senate, of the House of Representatives, yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The United States was at peace with that nation, and at the solicitation of Japan, was still in conversation with its government and its emperor, looking toward the maintenance of peace in the Pacific. Indeed, 1 hour after Japanese air squadrons had commenced bombing in the American island of Oahu, the Japanese ambassador to the United States and his colleague delivered to our Secretary of State a formal reply to a recent American message. And while this reply stated that it seemed useless to continue the existing diplomatic negotiations, it contained no threat or hint of war or of armed attack. It will be recorded that the distance of Hawaii from Japan makes it obvious that the attack was deliberately planned many days or even weeks ago. During the intervening time, the Japanese government has deliberately sought to deceive the United States by false statements and expressions of hope for continued peace. The attack yesterday on the Hawaiian Islands has caused severe damage to American naval and military forces. I regret to tell you that very many American lives have been lost. In addition, American ships have been reported torpedoed on the high seas between San Francisco and Honolulu. Yesterday, the Japanese government also launched an attack against Malaya. Last night, Japanese forces attacked Hong Kong. Last night, Japanese forces attacked Guam. Last night, Japanese forces attacked the Philippine Islands. Last night, the Japanese attacked Wake Island. And this morning, the Japanese attacked Midway Island. Japan has therefore undertaken a surprise offensive extending throughout the Pacific area. The facts of yesterday and today speak for themselves. The people of the United States have already formed their opinions and well understand the implications to the very life and safety of our nation. As Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy, I have directed that all measures be taken for our defense, but always will our whole nation remember the character of the onslaught against us. No matter how long it may take us to overcome this premeditated invasion, the American people in their righteous might will win through to absolute victory. I believe that I interpret the will of the Congress and of the people when I assert that we will not only defend ourselves to the uttermost, but will make it very certain that this form of treachery shall never again endanger us. Hostilities exist. There is no blinking at the fact that our people, our territory, and our interests are in grave danger. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God. I ask that the Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
To leave the house. The house will recess at this time. The president is going out of the gallery now, and there's some business going on at the platform at this time. And so for the conclusion of the ceremonies taking place at this time, we shall return you now to the platform. We see now that the joint session of Congress, the House, and the Senate, including the cabinet members and the Supreme Court, has concluded. And so, thus, we are going to conclude our broadcast at this point, unless Mr. Warner has a few words to say concerning what has occurred at this time. Here is Mr. Albert Warner, Columbia's Washington news analyst.
This has been a brief and simple joint session of the Senate and House. The Speaker of the House of Representatives, Sam Rabin, and Vice President Wallace presided on the rostrum. In front of the rostrum were the cabinet members, members of the Supreme Court in their robes, and behind them the senators and the members of the House of Representatives. The president came in promptly at 12:30. There was a tremendous ovation given to him as he stood there in front of the microphones at a little desk in front of the Vice President and Speaker Rabin. The president made a brief, moving speech, frequently interrupted by applause, at the end of which he declared that a state of war already was existing between Japan and the United States. Now the chamber is in brief recess while the Senate goes back across the corridors of this long building to its own chamber on the other side, where it will meet at once in its own session. Then the House will get into action here, and a resolution will be introduced by the majority floor leader, Representative McCormick, declaring the existence of a state of war. Now here is Eric Severard.
The members of the Senate have just left the House of Representatives to go down through the hallway to their own chamber. They left walking by twos up the main aisle toward the gate, following immediately after the members of the Supreme Court. The justices of the Supreme Court were dressed in their long black robes, and they too left in twos, and as they passed, many members of the Congress in their seats arose to applaud them. That was the immediately after the president finished his short 10-minute speech. You heard the completely deafening applause, at least it was deafening here to us, standing watching when he said that the American people, in their righteous might, would win through. When he had finished, it was almost impossible from the circumference of the room to see the president. Men stood on their chairs, people stood on the railings back by the gallery. All the spectators up above were on their feet. They were applauding and they were shouting. And then the president left very quickly and simply, and there was a quiet moment, and then it was announced the senators and representatives would remain in their seats until the members of the Supreme Court and then the cabinet had passed out. And now the business of the Congress in its respective chambers is beginning again. We can just hear the voice of the speaker.
We've been advised that this time a vote will be taken. The senators and representatives will vote on a declaration of war, or declaration of existence of a state of war. And we will, at this time, attempt to bring you a description of the ceremonies taking place in regard to this. We have our microphones on the committee tables, on the well in front of the speaker's platform, and, of course, on the speaker's platform where President Roosevelt spoke. The vote will be taken shortly, the various senators voting on the measure and so on. And so for the ceremonies that will take place regarding that, we're going to keep Columbia's microphones open and attempt to bring you the complete program of the events taking place at this time. We heard through the doorway here that some vote was being taken regarding the measure to be passed. And as yet, there is nothing taking place on the speaker's platform, but we're sure that shortly the vote will be taken. The senators will answer yea and nay and so on, and we shall attempt to bring you that when they do, provided that is to take place in the usual manner, so that we can present it to our radio audience. There is a bulletin dated Berlin. A Nazi military spokesman says that attempts to capture Moscow this winter have been abandoned. Attempts to capture Moscow this winter have been abandoned, a Nazi spokesman says. The bulletin dated Berlin. The speaker is pounding the gavel, and we take you now to the speaker's platform.
It may take a moment to reinstall the speaker system. Then we will proceed to business.
Now, I think I'll refer this thing, however.
Gentlemen, Masters, Mr. McCormick.
Mr. Speaker, I move that the message of the President of the United States...
Well, gentlemen will suspend the in order and the galleries as well. Gentlemen from Massachusetts.
Mr. Speaker, I move that the message of the President of the United States be referred to the Committee on Foreign Affairs and audit printed.
Objection is to order.
Mr. Speaker, I move to suspend the rules and pass the joint resolution which I have sent to the desk.
Clerk will report the resolution.
House joint resolution 254. Joint resolution declaring that a state of war exists between the Imperial Government of Japan and the government and the people of the United States, and making provisions to prosecute the same. Whereas the Imperial Government of Japan has committed repeated acts of war against the government and the people of the United States of America, therefore be it resolved by the Senate and House of Representatives of the United States of America in Congress assembled, that the state of war between the United States and the Imperial Government of Japan, which has thus been thrust upon the United States, is hereby formally declared, and that the President be and he is hereby authorized and directed to employ the entire naval and military forces of the United States and the resources of the government to carry on war against the Imperial Government of Japan and to bring the conflict to a successful termination, all of the resources of the country are hereby pledged by the Congress of the United States.
Is the second demanded?
Oh. Speaker, I demand a second.
Gentlemen from Nuts, there can be no objection. Not a unanimous consent request.
Speaker, I yield 20 seconds to myself.
Gentlemen from Massachusetts is recognized for 20 seconds.
Mr. Speaker, my fellow Americans, the President of the United States has just spoken to the Congress and to the American people. A dastardly attack has been made upon us. This is the time for action.
Gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Martin.
Mr. Speaker, our nation is today in the gravest crisis since its establishment as a republic. All we hold precious and sacred is being challenged by a ruthless, unscrupulous, arrogant foe. We have been the victim of a treacherous attack under cover of darkness. It came at a time when we were trying to establish a basis of peace through mutual misunderstanding. Our ships have been sunk, our planes destroyed, many lives lost. Cities and towns under the American flag have been ruthlessly bombed. No one hates war more than I. Every night I have uttered a silent prayer that America might be spared active involvement in a frightful war. I know the horrors which come with war, the loss of lives, the sacrifices which must be made by all, the sadness and desolation it always brings. America is challenged. That challenge comes in a ruthless way which leaves but one answer for a liberty-loving, self-respecting people. We are compelled by this treacherous attack to go to war. Now, from now on, there can be no hesitation. We must press the war with unstinted vigor and full efficiency. There can be no peace until the enemy is made to pay in full measure for his dastardly crime. We in America wanted peace. We must now fight to uphold our national honor and make secure our freedom. The attack on our territory will rally every patriotic American the support of the nation's need. In shipyards, in factories, in mines, in blast furnaces, on farms all over this broad land, there will be one spontaneous response. The people of America will unanimously meet the attacks of the aggressor and join in an irresistible effort of increased production. The boys in the training camps and the sailors who maintain the vigils of the sea must have, they will have, the tools and equipment to win this war. In view of the developments of the past 48 hours, the President's request has my support. When the historic roll is called, I hope there will not be a single dissenting voice. Let us show the world we are a united nation. Let us boldly proclaim we will not permit any force to strike down freedom and progress here in America or replace our way of life with slavery and dictatorship. God will give us the strength and the courage to drive to victory in a just cause, a cause which means all that makes life worthwhile to the people, not only of America, but in every country in the world.
be long.
Mr. Speaker?
I yield 3 minutes. The gentleman from New York to speak. Yes?
Let us maintain order at this time, especially. The gentleman from New York, Mr. Fish, is recognized for 3 minutes.
Mr. Speaker, it is with sorrow and deep resentment against Japan that I rise to support a declaration of war. I have consistently opposed our entrance into wars in Europe and Asia for the past 3 years. But the unwarranted, vicious, brazen, and dastardly attack by the Japanese Navy and Air Force while peace negotiations were pending at Washington, and in defiance of the President's 11th-hour personal appeal to the Emperor, makes war inevitable and necessary. The time for debate and controversy within America has passed. The time for action has come. Interventionists and non-interventionists must cease criminations and recriminations, charges and countercharges against each other, and present a united front behind the President and the government in the conduct of the war. There can only be one answer to the treacherous attack of the Japanese, and that is war to final victory, cost what it may, in blood, treasure, and tears. This unprovoked and senseless aggression by the Japanese armed forces upon our possessions must be answered by war. Although I have consistently fought against intervention in foreign wars, I have repeatedly stated that if we are attacked by any foreign nation, or if the Congress of the United States declared war in the American and constitutional way, I would support the President and the administration to the bitter end. Mr. Speaker, whom the gods would destroy, they first make mad. The Japanese have gone stark raving mad, and their unprovoked attack has committed for them military, naval, and national suicide. I shall at the proper time volunteer my services as an officer in a combat division, as I did in the last war, preferably with colored troops. There is no sacrifice too great that I will not make in defense of America and to help annihilate these war-mad Japanese devils. Now that we are to fight, let us go in with our heads up and our chins up in the American way. Let us serve notice upon the world that this is not only a war against aggression and in defense of our own territories, but a war for freedom and democracy all over the world, and that we will not stop until victory is won. I appeal to all American citizens, particularly the members of my own party and to non-interventionists, to put aside personal views and non-partisan and all partisanship and unite behind the President, our Commander-in-Chief, in assuring victory to the armed forces of the United States.
Desires to say this, and that is that whoever is responsible for these lights will turn them off. Gentleman from
Massachusetts. Mr. Speaker.
Gentleman from Massachusetts.
I yield 2 minutes to the gentleman from New York, Mr. Bloom.
Gentleman from New York, Mr. Bloom, is recognized for 2 minutes.
Mr. Speaker, speedy action. Not words should be the order of the day.
The gentleman from Massachusetts.
Mr. Speaker. Of course, there's two gentlemen from Massachusetts. I yield 2 minutes to the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Johnson.
From Texas, Mr. Luther Johnson is recognized.
Tragic hour, words will not convey our feelings or express our righteous indignation. Japan's unprovoked attack without notice upon the United States, while peace negotiations were still in progress, was dastard treachery and is characteristic of those totalitarian outlaws who talk peace while they have already drawn the dagger with which to strike. We have but two choices today, either to fight or to surrender. And America, thank God, has never surrendered and never will surrender. America is united. America will fight. America will win.
Hello, Mr. Martin.
Speaker, I yield 1 minute to the lady from Massachusetts, Mrs. Rogers.
That woman from Massachusetts is recognized for a minute.
Mr. Speaker, yesterday Japan stabbed us in the back. The indignation of the American people knows no bounds. Those of every strain in this country will rise to meet that challenge. They will fight to defend America. Grim and awful as war is, they want war declared. Mr. Speaker, I remind you that the American men have been brave. American women, too, have been brave. They are willing today to make every sacrifice in order that we shall win. Thank God, Mr. Speaker, the country today is united, and united we march forward to victory.
Mr. Speaker, I yield 1 minute to the gentlewoman from Maryland, Mrs. Byron. Gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Casey.
Mr. Speaker, rise together today and the divide of the people on our moral policy. And the divide of the people and the philosophy, our resources, our genius, and all the cause of the people of life. America was a sleeping giant. Today, America is united. Today, America is awake. Soon the world will know that a peace-loving people can and carry around strike at all the force.
Mr. Speaker, we Americans all, at this hour, lay upon the altar of our country and our country's cause life and honor and all that we hold dear.
Speaker, I yield 2 minutes to the gentleman from New Jersey.
New Jersey,
Mr. Speaker, yesterday, since the roar of the Japanese cannon, we American people heard a trumpet call.
Because the Speaker of the House of Representatives, Sam Rayburn, has ruled that the proceedings from the floor cannot be broadcast, we're forced to conclude this portion of our program and present at this time Mr. Albert Warner, Columbia's Washington news analyst. Mr. Warner.
The majority floor leader, Representative McCormick, opened the brief speech-making after the President of the United States had concluded his address to the joint session. Mr. McCormick called the Japanese attack dastardly, He said that the time has now come for action. Then the Republican leader of the House, who was also chairman of the Republican National Committee, Representative Joseph Martin, said that all we hold precious is now at stake, that we have been the victim of dastardly attack, that our cities and ships have been bombed by Japanese planes. And he said that every night he had uttered prayers that this country would be spared from war. War meant sadness and desolation. But now there was only one answer for a liberty-loving people. We are compelled, said Representative Martin, to go to war. There can be no peace, he said, until the enemy has paid for its crimes. We must drive ahead to victory in a just war. Isolationist Representative Fish, a Republican of New York, who has consistently opposed the president's foreign policies, spoke after Representative Martin, taking much the same line as the Republican leader had done. He said that in view of the brazen, vicious, dastardly attack, war is necessary. The vote in the Senate adopting this resolution declaring the existence of a state of war with Japan was adopted 82-0. 82-0. Representative Fish said, told his colleagues that he had consistently opposed what he called interventionism, but now he said the time for debate and controversy had passed. It was time for a united front. And though he had consistently spoken against the president's foreign policies, he said, he would now support the administration to the bitter end. The Japanese, he said, had gone stark mad. Whom the gods would destroy, they first make mad, he declared. While these and other people were speaking 1, 2, or 3 minute speeches, Representative Jeanette Rankin stood at the back of the hall trying to get the attention of the speaker. Miss Rankin was a congresswoman at the time of the First World War, and then she voted against the declaration of war on Germany. What she wanted to say on this occasion is not yet known. She did not get a chance to speak. For 20 years, she was out of Congress. She came back to the House just in time to vote on a second declaration of war. Now here's Park Simmons.
As we conclude this broadcast from the House, which has brought you the address of the President, the United States is now at war with Japan. We return you now to New York.
Here at Columbia's microphones in New York are Elmer Davis and Major George Fielding Elliott. We shall hear first from Mr. Davis.
Nevertheless, from a military point of view, it was a defeat which may have, so far as we know about the operations up to this time, which may have some effect on the naval strategy of the Pacific in the months to come. Of that you will hear more presently from Major Elliott. Meanwhile, the fact had better be recognized because it is going to take hard work and possibly time to repair the losses which we have already suffered. And as President Roosevelt says, no matter how long it may take us, the American people will win through to absolute victory. Note the words, absolute victory. He said also, we will make very certain that this form of treachery will never again endanger us. That is to say, a mere halfway victory, a show victory, will not be sufficient. And that was the implication, too, of Representative Martin's statement that no, there can be no peace till the enemy has been made to pay in full measure. This proposal today, of course, is for declaration of war only against Japan. What is to be done about Japan's allies is a problem which has not yet been decided perhaps in Washington, and which perhaps those allies will decide for us. The Triple Alliance between Germany, Italy, and Japan provides that every one of them comes to the rescue of the others in case it is attacked by a power which was not engaged in the war at the time of the signing of the alliance. Theoretically, it must be attacked, but of course we have seen in the history of the Axis states that they can always represent themselves as attacked, and there have been indications from the European Axis capitals that they will so represent this operation. The Germans insisted yesterday that the war incendiary Roosevelt was solely responsible for the breaking out of hostilities. They have repeated that statement over and over, and so it seems probable that they will represent this as an American attack on Japan, fact which they could easily persuade their peoples, or at least could suppress any evidence of dissent, so that the operation of the Triple Alliance will come into effect automatically. And that, of course, would lead to a state of war between the United States and Germany and Italy. Meanwhile, it must be obvious that the presence of the German and Italian embassies in Washington is dangerous to our interests, since they are centers of Axis activity and doubtless would give such assistance as they could to the Japanese. And to those might be added the embassy of Vichy, France, for the whole history of the French government in Indochina in the past year and a half has indicated that it has been functioning as a very willing assistant to whatever claims for domination the Japanese may make. They have helped them already. They will no doubt help them still more. Another point indicating the tie-up of this Japanese attack with all the Axis strategy may be inferred from its timing. It is clear that the attack was prepared at least 3 weeks ago. That is to say, not only about the time Mr. Kurusu was on his way from Tokyo to Washington with what were represented at the time as proposals for peace negotiations, but also at a time when the situation of the German armies in Russia was very much more favorable than it is now. 3 or 4 weeks ago, it could well have been supposed by the Axis that by this time the German armies would have made a triumphal entrance into Moscow, that they would be pushing on from Rostov either towards Astrakhan or to the Caucasus, that the Russian situation would be very favorable to them, and that such a timing of the Japanese attack on the United States would be a great boost to the world progress of the Axis. Well, things didn't go as they were expected to go in Russia. We have just heard the statement of a German spokesman that the attempt to take Moscow this winter has now been abandoned. It would be rash to put any too much confidence in this statement, but at least it does indicate that they don't seem to have much expectation of getting ahead in Moscow, and we know that on the Rostov front, they are now moving westward and not eastward, and they have taken some severe losses there. All this changes very materially the situation as it was expected to be at the time the Japanese planned their attack. Nevertheless, it is obvious that the initial attack has attained some successes, and that it will take a great deal of effort, a united, vigorous, all-out effort by the entire American people to retrieve the initial setbacks. There is every evidence that the American people are prepared to make that effort. It was indicated by the spontaneous cheers that broke out in Congress, by the statements of men who have hitherto been most vigorously opposed to any involvement in hostilities, and there is every reason to suppose that this is a correct representation of the state of mind of the people. That is a state of mind, apparently unanimous, that has been created by this unprovoked, surprise Japanese attack while their negotiators were still talking peace in Washington. The Japanese tactics have won them an initial military victory. It seems very likely that its ultimate effects will be far more than overbalanced by the consequence of the political defeat which Japanese treachery has brought on itself.
Here is Major George Fielding Elliott.
As Mr. Davis has pointed out, and as the President told the Congress, it is perfectly clear that this Japanese attack has been in course of preparation for some time. Let us examine for a moment the technical points involved. A Japanese submarine torpedoed an American merchant vessel between San Francisco and Honolulu, about 700 miles west of San Francisco. Another such ship was attacked about 1,300 miles west of San Francisco. Now, Japanese submarines or any other submarines are not particularly fast vessels, even cruising on the surface. And under the best conditions, that is, under conditions in which they do not have to avoid observation by American patrol aircraft, which are operating all over the Central Pacific, a direct passage from Yokohama or from any other Japanese home base to the places where these submarines appeared would occupy at least 12 days. We may assume that the period was considerably longer because of the necessity of avoiding being seen while on passage. Again, the attack against Hawaii, delivered from aircraft carriers, would have taken at least 8 days for the carriers at economical cruising speeds, and they could not have proceeded at high speed because of the wastage of fuel involved. Take at least 8 days from Yokosuka, which is the nearest large Japanese naval base. And it must be remembered that it would have taken at least another week to prepare the carriers for this operation. Secure their full complements of aircraft, load them with bombs, stores, and so on, and make ready. Period, therefore, of 15 days at least from the time the preparations were actually begun. And we must assume, of course, that there were several days in making plans and taking decisions. Consequently, it is perfectly clear that this attack was treacherously planned long before it took place and during the course of peace negotiations. This is a fact which cannot be too strongly emphasized. The President gave one item of military news which we had not had before, and that is the Japanese attack on Midway Island, which is an important American island air base in the Pacific and the nearest of the air bases to Hawaii on the long string of such bases which extend from Hawaii to Manila. From Singapore comes a bulletin stating that confused fighting continues in the Cotabaro aerodrome sector in northern Malaya. This is an official communique and is the first admission that Japanese landing parties have actually reached the Cotabaro area. Cotabaro is an isolated British aerodrome in the extreme northeastern corner of British Malaya. It does not have good road connections with the interior, although it does have connection with the Malayan railways. A Japanese attack on this aerodrome would probably be intended to secure the use of the aerodrome for Japanese land-based airplanes. After all, the number of carriers available is limited, and the Japanese must, if they're going to continue an attack on Singapore, be able to operate land-based airplanes in that area. A British radio reporting on Japanese troop landings in Malaya said, 5 enemy merchant vessels escorted by warships brought the first Japanese troops to the Malayan coast. Later, 10 more vessels were located further south. RAF bombers attacked them in the moonlight, and by dawn, at least 2 large enemy ships had been hit and set on fire. At daybreak, several of our bomber and torpedo bomber squadrons took off to complete the attack. The result of these attacks is not yet known. Following these attacks, the Japanese ships retired at high speed, leaving their troops behind on the beaches to fight it out. It should be observed that the British should have air superiority in this whole region, and that air superiority is generally considered prohibitive as regards to troop landing. Thus, the British certainly have initial advantages, and it remains to be seen how they can develop themselves. From Berlin comes a report that Japanese troops have begun peaceful occupation of Thailand in the direction of Bangkok and numerous other important points in the east and south. Apparently, Thai resistance to Japanese attack, if any took place at all, was merely a token resistance and has not amounted to anything. So that the Japanese at Cotabaro may now be hoping to maintain themselves until such time as assistance can reach them through Thai territory. Cotabaro is almost on the frontier between British Malaya and Thailand, and the Japanese may hope to hang on there till their comrades can come racing down through Thai territory to join them. But there are also reports that British troops have already moved into Thai territory, presumably from Malaya, and delaying actions may take place on the isthmus in Thai territory, which occupies the narrowest part of that long
600-mile isthmus, which is known as the Malay Peninsula. The Germans announced that attempts to capture Moscow will be abandoned for the winter. This may be a ruse, of course. It may be, however, due to the Russian pressure in the south and the absolute need for stemming that pressure in order to avoid a disaster to the German armies there. For the last week or 10 days, there has been noticeable, to military observers, the first hint of a certain German lack of means. That is, they do not seem to be able to put on attacks on the same broad scale and with the same reckless disregard of casualties to men and material that they did before. Noticeable that, this is as regards land troops, that they do seem to feel pressure in one area on their operations in another. And it may very well be that they are compelled to abandon their attacks on Moscow in order to make secure their position in the south. We have just received a dispatch from Tegucigalpa, Honduras, that Honduras declared war on Japan today and the government established martial law throughout the republic. This adds the name of Honduras to those of Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Haiti, which have already declared war on Germany and on Japan, and also Mexico, Colombia, and Cuba, which have indicated their intention of doing likewise or of taking steps which are tantamount to such action. We ought to remember, in considering the coming of these countries to our side, that although their military power may not be very great, it is of enormous importance that American air and naval forces have the use of their territories, air bases, and seaports in defending our far-flung lines of communication in the Caribbean Sea and in the Pacific, and that the belligerent status of these countries gives our Navy facilities which it could not otherwise possess. Especially with regard to Costa Rica and Colombia, these countries are immediately adjacent to the Panama Canal, and both of them possess island bases from which our outlying patrol squadrons and our listening stations can perhaps observe the approach of any attempt by Japanese or other forces to surprise the canal in the same manner that Hawaii appears to have been surprised. There is no further report in the President's message on the exact extent of the damage which was suffered by the American forces at Hawaii, other than to say that the loss of life was severe. And apparently, severe damage was done. The Japanese have made a number of claims with regard to this damage, which appear to be exaggerated. However, it is noticeable that the President has said in an earlier statement from the White House that operations at Hawaii were continuing. Whether this means that the Japanese are making another attack, or whether it means that the pursuit of the Japanese carriers and perhaps other escorting ships which brought the planes to Hawaii is continuing, of course, is uncertain. There is always the possibility to be kept in mind that the Japanese may have backed up the carriers with their whole battle fleet, hoped to inflict some damage on our ships in harbor, and to bring the remainder to action while they were pursuing the carriers. But this is mere speculation and has nothing to support it at the present time. In view, however, of the wide extent of the Japanese surprise attacks yesterday, extending over an area almost a quarter of a distance around the globe, the possibility cannot be excluded that there may yet be other surprise raids at points where attack would seem as little to be expected as at Pearl Harbor. An imaginative preview of an American-Japanese war was written a dozen years ago by H.C. Bywater, the English naval expert. It was a work of fiction, but it was based on an expert's knowledge of the possibilities, if not the probabilities. And one of the incidents which he imagined was the conversion of certain Japanese merchantmen into airplane carriers, still with the outward appearance of merchantmen and sailing under neutral flags, from which air raids were made on coastal cities of the continental United States. It is known that certain Japanese merchant ships have been converted into airplane carriers, although these have long flying decks and their appearance is no longer that of merchant ships. A vessel which retains the appearance of a merchant ship can, however, operate seaplanes. Such vessels could carry very few planes. The damage which might be done by such raids upon our coast would be comparatively trivial. Their sole purpose would be to cause confusion, and that purpose could be defeated by the coolness and self-control of the civilian population if such an incident should occur. It is to be hoped that we will be a little more ready for such surprise attacks now than we were during the continuance of the peace negotiations, when we, at least the people at large, had the idea that the Japanese were really trying to come to some agreement. The likelihood that such carriers could slip through American naval patrols in the Pacific or the Atlantic is small indeed. Still, it is a conceivable possibility which all of us should bear in mind.
You've heard from Elmer Davis and Major George Fielding Elliott. Now here are late reports from the press associations. Congress has just declared war on Japan. Both the Senate and the House have approved resolutions calling for a war declaration. The Senate voted 82-0 in favor of it within 20 minutes after the President asked a joint session of Congress to do so. Shortly thereafter, the House voted similar approval. The only vote against the war resolution in the House so far was by Miss Jeanette Rankin, Republican of Montana. Miss Rankin also voted against the declaration of war against Germany in 1917. Representative Harold Knutson, Republican of Minnesota, who also voted against American entry into the World War in 1917, said today, "This nation has no choice but to declare war on Japan." "I do not see that we have any other choice," Knutson told reporters. "They declared war on us." Miss Rankin and Knutson are the only present members of the House who voted against war in 1917. Here's a dispatch from Berlin. A DNB dispatch tonight from Tokyo, quoting a report in the Japanese newspaper Yomiuri from Saigon, French Indochina, said a United States transport had been sunk with a loss of 350 men in waters around Manila. And from Port-au-Prince, Haiti. Haiti joined the Latin American nations today, which have declared war on Japan, and pledged the United States its full assistance. The Berlin Radio reported from Vichy today, and the report follows. In an official French comment from Vichy on the outbreak of war between Japan and the United States and Britain, it is pointed out that France was adopting an attitude of wait and see. It was furthermore stressed that for the time being, France was still neutral in the Pacific and the Far East, and that her attitude had not yet changed. The vote in the House was 388-1. Next special news broadcast will be heard over many of these stations at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, when we shall hear the speech of Prime Minister Winston Churchill from London. Columbia will continue to interrupt all regularly scheduled programs to bring you the latest news. Big Sister, The Romance of Helen Trent, Argyle Sunday, Life Can Be Beautiful, and Woman in White will be heard at their regularly scheduled times tomorrow. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.